welcome to everyone who has come here today to worship the risen Christ. For our worship service on this, the fifth Sunday of Easter, we make use of the worship that is printed in the bulletin, which is Divine Service 2. Let's begin our worship today by singing the opening hymn, which is an Easter hymn, hymn number 141. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Have mercy on me, O God, according to your steadfast love. According to your abundant mercy, blot out my transgressions. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity, and cleanse me from my sin. Let us then confess our sins to God, our gracious Father. Almighty God, merciful Father, we poor sinners beseech you to hear our words of repentance. We have sinned against you and have transgressed your commands in thought, word, and deed. We have done the evil you forbid and have not done the good you demand. We do repent and are truly sorry for all our sins, both known and unknown to us. Have mercy on us because of Jesus, our Savior. Grant that by the working of the Holy Spirit, we may walk as your forgiven and restored children here on earth until that time when we finally come into your glorious heavenly presence. God has promised his mercy and forgiveness to those who repent of their sins and turn to him in repentance and humility. In the stead and by the command of my Lord Jesus Christ, I forgive you all your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. May our merciful Lord keep you steadfast in the Holy Spirit, lead you to greater faith and obedience, and bring you to live with him forever, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. For the well-being of all people everywhere, that they may receive from you all they need to sustain body and life, hear our prayer, O Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the spread of your life-giving gospel throughout the world, that all who are lost in sin may be brought to faith in you, hear our prayer, O Christ. Christ, have mercy. For patience and perseverance in this life, that we may not lose the hope of eternal life, as we await your return, hear our prayer, O Lord. Lord, have mercy. Lord of life, live in us that we may live for you.
Amen.
In the peace of forgiveness, let us praise the Lord. Let your continual mercy, O Lord, cleanse and defend your church, and because it cannot continue in safety without your help, protect and govern it always by your goodness. For you live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated. The first scripture lesson for this, the fifth Sunday of Easter, is the Old Testament lesson for the day recorded in the book of 1 Samuel, chapter 20, beginning at verse 12. The Old Testament lesson will serve as our sermon text for this morning. Then Jonathan said to David, "I swear by the Lord, the God of Israel, that I will surely sound out my father by this time, the day after tomorrow. If he is favorably disposed toward you, will I not send you word and let you know? But if my father intends to harm you, may the Lord deal with Jonathan, be it ever so severely, if I do not let you know and send you away in peace. May the Lord be with you, as he has been with my father." But show me unfailing kindness like the Lord's kindness, as long as I live, so that I may not be killed, and do not ever cut off your kindness from my family, not even when the Lord has cut off every one of David's enemies from the face of the earth. So Jonathan made a covenant with the house of David, saying, may the Lord call David's enemies to account. And Jonathan had David reaffirm his oath out of love for him, because he loved him as he loved himself. Here ends the first scripture lesson. We'll now hear the singing of the Sunday school children. Please rise for the Holy Gospel. The Gospel according to St. John, the 13th chapter. Glory be to you, O Lord. When he was gone, Jesus said, "Now the Son of Man is glorified, and God is glorified in him. If God is glorified in him, God will glorify the Son in himself, and will glorify him at once. My children, I will be with you only a little longer. You will look for me, and just as I told the Jews, so I tell you now, where I am going, you cannot come. A new command I give you, love one another. As I have loved you, so you must love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you love one another." This is the Gospel of the Lord.
Praise be to you, O Christ.
We confess our Christian faith with the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit, the Virgin Mary, and became fully human. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who in unity with the Father and the Son is worshiped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. We sing the hymn of the day, which is hymn 497. You may be seated.
I chose you.
Grace, mercy, and peace are yours from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. The sermon text for today is the Old Testament lesson recorded in the book of 1 Samuel, chapter 20, beginning at verse 12. I'll read the last verse of our text. And Jonathan had David reaffirm his oath of love for him, because he loved him as he loved himself. And we pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be pleasing in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, in Paul's final exhortation to the believers who lived in the city of Philippi, he wrote this in chapter 4. Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. As I read those words, I ask myself the simple question, is there anything left in this world that is true and noble and pure and praiseworthy and admirable? You know what has happened in our world today, right? The things that are good have been declared bad or evil, and the evil things have been declared good. We live in a world where things are upside down. To give you an example, just try to imagine what modern-day Bible scholars do with the text that is before us this morning. They take something that is good and noble and turn it into something that is ugly. They sexualize that relationship between Jonathan and David. They pervert it and they make it something that is sinful and ugly. And yet, I think that this friendship between Jonathan and David serves as a wonderful example of what Jesus commanded in our gospel lesson for today, namely, that we should love one another. And I was thinking about this the other day, that Jesus commands us to love one another. He tells us that we are to love our neighbor as ourselves. And if I'm not mistaken about this, my neighbor comes in two forms, split right down the middle percentage-wise. My neighbor consists of men and of women. And so Jesus is commanding me to love my neighbor, both men and women, as I love myself. And that's why I think at the end of our text, we find something that is pure and noble and praiseworthy and admirable. I'll read it for you again. Jonathan loved David as he loved himself. Today, let's think about something like that, something that is noble and true. Who are these two men? Well, let's start out with Jonathan. He was the son of the first king of Israel, King Saul. Jonathan was the firstborn son, and so that meant he was first in the line of succession to become king. But Jonathan was also a great warrior. In chapter 14 of 1 Samuel, we hear that he, on his own, attacked a Philistine outpost. And when he did that, God struck the Philistines with panic, and Israel that day won a great victory, even though they didn't have any swords. Well, the Philistines responded, of course, and they brought their army and their champion, a guy named Goliath, and now enters David, right? David, son of Jesse, from Bethlehem, that shepherd boy. David went out and met Goliath and won a great victory for Israel on that day by defeating Goliath. And we hear in the book of 1 Samuel that on that day, Jonathan and David became great friends. Literally, they became one in spirit. As far as these two men go, Jonathan at this time was probably married and had kids, and David would soon be married and he would have kids as well. And I guess if we were going to describe them in modern terms, we would say about Jonathan and David that they were the Navy SEALs of their day. Ferocious warriors, brave in battle, but more importantly, they were believers in the God of Israel. Did you happen to notice how many times in our text Jonathan mentions the God of Israel? You see, both these men realized they were recipients of God's love. Both of these men trusted that God would someday send for them a Savior. Both men were devout followers of the Lord God. Today, let's watch and listen as they go about what God's people go about, namely, obeying the new command. What does obeying the new command mean? Well, it means, first from our text, obeying that command, love one another, in the midst of your family. Now, God's people are part of two kingdoms. You're part of a heavenly kingdom, but you're also part of an earthly kingdom, which is the United States of America. And we have responsibilities in each kingdom. Jesus indicated this when he said, "Render unto Caesar the things that are Caesar's, and unto God the things that are God's." You and I are also part of two different families. We are part of the family of God, and yet we are also part of an earthly family as well, right? And things go well when our responsibilities in those families do not conflict with one another. But sometimes they do come into conflict. And what happens then? Well, the modern way of doing things in our country today goes like this. So families need to stick together no matter what. So with that logic, if one family member falls into some deep sin or deep transgression, then it's supposedly the responsibility of the rest of the family members to rally around that person, to support them, to condone whatever they are doing no matter what. That's the way it works with modern families today. After all, we are a family, the saying goes, right? And you have to get together, you know, for those family events, and you don't want to have a knife fight at Christmas, now do you? So you just have to roll with it, right? Well, let's apply that same logic to the family of Saul with his son Jonathan. You know, for whatever reason, Saul became jealous of David. He wanted him dead. He saw him as standing in the way to his son Jonathan becoming the next king of Israel. And so Saul gave David some really dangerous assignments, hoping that he would be killed carrying those out. One day, when David was playing his musical instrument for Saul, Saul took his spear and he hurled it at David, trying to pin him to the wall. Saul hated David. Okay, so if Jonathan then took the modern approach, he would have said, "Well, family is family, and my dad hates David, so I'm going to hate David as well, and my dad wants David dead, so I want David dead as well, and by the way, that would be better for me, because nobody would be standing in the way of me becoming the second king of Israel." Really? Whatever happened to Saul? You know, Saul started out on such a good footing. He was anointed to be the first king of Israel. Initially, he was brave in battle. Initially, he was a follower of the God of Israel. But then something happened. I think he became drunk with power. But nonetheless, God still loved Saul. He wanted Saul to repent. And Jonathan even says that the Lord has been with my dad. But eventually the Lord God allowed an evil spirit to afflict Saul, and things got so bad that God said, that's it, I've had enough of Saul and his family. I am going to make sure that David becomes the second king of Israel. So God sent his prophet Samuel to anoint David, son of Jesse. Instead of joining his dad, Jonathan recognized that it was the Lord's will that he not become king, but that instead David become king. Jonathan was not willing to join with his dad in his evil plot to kill David. And in our text, we learn that David, for fear of his life, intended to be absent from a new moon festival. And so Jonathan says to David, I'm going to go and I'm going to sound out my dad to see what his attitude is toward you. And if it's bad, I'm going to tell you. If it's good, I'm going to tell you. We don't hear about it in our text, but Jonathan did exactly that. And when he got to that festival, his dad wanted to know where David was. And his dad got extremely angry with him and basically accused him of being a traitor. And he said that he was the son of a perverse woman. Imagine that. He throws Jonathan's mom under the bus as well. And he picks up his spear and he hurls it at his son Jonathan, trying to kill him. Jonathan didn't agree with his dad. Jonathan knew that it was the new command to love one another. And he was going to love David no matter what kind of trouble that brought to him in his family. Why? Because it was the right thing to do. Because it was the Lord's will. Because it was part of being on the side of what was true and right and noble. As you can see from our text, loving each other in an earthly family setting, it's not always an easy thing to do. Obeying the new command, obeying in a family setting. Loving in a family setting, not always easy. Next, we see in our text that obeying the new command means loving and returning love that is shown. In John chapter 13, Jesus spoke the words, love one another, and that's the same chapter in which we learn that Jesus showed his disciples the full extent of his love. Do you remember how he did that? He got down on his knees and he washed his disciples' feet, acting as a servant or a slave. He even washed his enemy's feet, that enemy known as Judas. Jesus showed to his disciples love because he wanted them to love in return. Now, how do you get love to come back to you? Parents, how do you get your kids to love you? Do you ream them out constantly, yell at them? Does that work? Spouses, how do you get your spouse to love you in return? Do you gripe and complain about their lack of love? Well, here's how Jesus did it, okay? Jesus wanted his disciples to love in return, and so he loved them. He said, love as I have loved you. He loved them deeply. He loved them with an unfailing love. He loved them with a love that took him to the cross of Calvary. He loved them with a love, he loves you with a love, that caused him to pour out his lifeblood on that cross. And yes, it's true, some did not respond to that love, but most did. They responded to that love by showing love in return. And that's why Jesus says in John chapter 13, love one another. Jesus even asked one of his disciples about this on the banks of the Sea of Galilee. Do you love me? Then show your love by feeding my lambs and feeding my sheep. And then Jesus says that this will be the one big identifier in our world, that we belong to Jesus and that we are his disciples, namely in the fact that we love one another. Jonathan loved his friend David. He defended him with his words. He promised to go and sound out his dad to find out what his dad's attitude was toward David. Jonathan also wanted to see love in return, and that's why he says to David in our text, "Show me unfailing kindness, like the Lord's kindness, as long as I live, so that I may not be killed, and do not ever cut off your kindness from my family." See, Jonathan accepted the truth that he wasn't going to be the king of Israel, that David was. We learn in 1 Samuel that Jonathan thought that he eventually would become David's right-hand man. Jonathan also believed that his Savior would come from David's family. But Jonathan was also thinking ahead. And he realized what happened in the ancient world when someone became king. If you became king, the first thing that you did is you killed off all of your rivals to the throne. So Jonathan is thinking, if David becomes king, I'm the number one rival to the throne. That's why Jonathan says, "Show love to me by not killing me." Jonathan also asks that David show love in return for his family, for his children, for his descendants. Well, as the story goes, things didn't work out for Jonathan the way he thought. Saul, Jonathan, and two younger brothers were killed in a battle against the Philistines. But David showed love in return. He went and he commended and blessed the men of a city called Jabesh-Gilead, because they risked their lives to retrieve those dead bodies of Saul and Jonathan and the two other brothers, and then they gave them a dignified burial. And then once David ascended to his throne, he asked a simple question: "Aren't there any relatives of Saul or Jonathan around that I can show love and kindness to?" And there was one, a man by the name of Mephibosheth, who was crippled in his feet. David said, "For the rest of your life, you're going to be part of my family, and you are going to eat at my table." You see, obeying the new command means showing love in return. Finally, obeying the new command means loving no matter what. Jesus said that as the end of the world approaches, the situation in earthly families is going to be difficult for believers, that parents will betray children unto death, children will betray parents unto death, and that the love of most will grow cold. I couldn't help but think about that statement this past week as I saw the video of that man in the city of Chicago who was knocked out. And people just stood there and watched for a very long time until he was finally run over and killed by a taxi cab. The love of most has grown cold in our world today. And I think that one major proof of this, or evidence of this, is the general lack of commitment in our world today. How did God's love first show itself in our sinful world? It first showed itself in the form of a commitment. "I will send the Savior. I will send the seed of the woman." And then God followed up on that commitment, right? Thousands of years later, in sending the Christ. We live in a world today where there is a general lack of commitment. People walk around in an uncommitted way. How else do you explain the fact that more and more people are just simply saying no to that lifelong commitment between one man and one woman, which is called marriage? People today say, "Forget it, it's too risky, who needs it?" Or what about other forms of commitment? Let's just take a simple form of commitment that is often asked of you. The pastor will stand up here after the service and he'll talk about these commitment forms all the time, right? They're called sign-up sheets. Sign up to bring some food after church. Sign up to help with a rummage sale. And people stand and they stare at those sheets and they think to themselves, whoa, I don't know if I put my name down on there. I'm committed to actually doing something. Something might come up. Something better might come up. I don't know if I want to do that. Or they'll look at a sheet and they'll say, you know, I'll sign up if somebody else does. I can't just do that on my own. I have to, first of all, see somebody else do that, and when nobody else does that, then nobody does it, right? Since when did our commitment become contingent on what other people do? That's not commitment. Commitment is saying, okay, this is what I'm going to do. This is what I intend to do by the grace of God, and I'm going to do that no matter what. Why all the questions about anybody else? Are there any others? It doesn't matter. Who cares? God's people love no matter what. And that love needs to take the form of commitment. And that's exactly what Jonathan did for David. He committed himself to David. In our text, we find that he made a covenant with the house of David. And a covenant is a contract. It is a commitment. Jonathan said, you know, no matter what happens, and I don't know what's going to happen in the future, I am going to show faithful love to the house of David, no matter what. Now, Christian love contains many different characteristics, like loyalty and truth, and using words to defend somebody, and using words to assure someone. But I think that today, from our text, we see that love needs also to take the form of commitment. Because that's the form of love that God shows toward you, a love of commitment. His commitment to you is everlasting. When is God ever going to say, oh, something better came up than your salvation? Or I'll accomplish this salvation if there's other people that will join in. No, not at all. Jesus came and he came alone and he came for you. His commitment to you is an everlasting commitment. And Paul writes about this commitment in Romans chapter 8. Neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Now that is commitment, right? And if you're still shaky on this commitment, this is what Jesus says to you today. Come, eat, drink, receive the blood of the covenant, the new covenant, the commitment, the contract that I make with you, so that you might be fully assured that I love you no matter what. Whatever is good, whatever is pure, whatever is noble, praiseworthy, admirable, think about these things. People of God, let's think about that relationship that Jonathan had with David and see in it a fulfillment of Christ's command, love one another. But let's also think about something that's even better. Let's think about a son who went to plead our case before a king, before his father. And of course, that son is Jesus. And he still does that to this day, pleading our case before his Father in heaven. Let us think about a son who desires to see love in return, and his approach to getting that is to love you with an eternal, unfailing love. and unshakable love. And let's think about a son who loved you no matter what, with a love of commitment, not stopping until he accomplished God's plan of salvation. A commitment to you that extends even to this day as he prepares a place for you in that home known as heaven. He's the one who gives to you something new, which isn't really new. It's as old as dirt, but it's new because it is radical. It is different. It sets us at odds with even our family members sometimes. And yet, this is his plan for our lives, namely, that we love one another as he has loved us. Amen. The peace of God that goes beyond all understanding will guard your hearts and minds through faith in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. We now worship God with our offerings. Rise for prayer. O Lord God, keep our hearts from making riches and other earthly things our treasure. Whenever we receive earthly blessings from you, refresh our memory with your greater mercy, which accepted Christ's suffering and death as atonement for our sins. Make eternal salvation the treasure we desire above all else. May the boundless love which provided the treasure produce in us a love which calls forth generous offerings, cheerfully and freely given. In the resurrected Savior's name we ask it. Amen. In our prayers this morning, we include a prayer for Donna Lane, who lost her mother, Dorothy Hart, a week ago. We also offer a prayer for Andy Petrie, who's currently hospitalized and recovering from a fractured hip, and Sheila McBean, who this coming week is going to have her second eye surgery. We pray. Lord God, you have given us the Holy Scriptures for our learning. Your Son, who loves us with an everlasting love, has given to us a new commandment that we are to love one another. In the Old Testament, you have given us a good and noble and pure example of godly love among faithful friends. Grant us the grace to not only think about such things, but also by your grace to love one another and thus to show to the world that we are your disciples. People who love because we have been loved first by you. Often in life, it appears due to the circumstances we face in a sinful world, such as sickness and tragedy, that you have withdrawn your love from us. At those times, holding the cross in front of our eyes thinking about Christ's love for us, help us to remember that your love is a committed love, an eternal love, a love for us that will never fail. Your people often get discouraged in a world where the love of most is growing cold. Example after example of this truth confronts us every day in the daily news. Instead of getting discouraged, help us to realize that in such an environment, obedience to the new command will become more and more noticeable and will stand in greater and greater contrast to what is happening in the world around us. Embolden your people by your Spirit to the simple yet often difficult privilege of loving one another. Father, we thank you that this past week our preschool survived the visit of the accreditation team. We thank you for the work of all who contributed to the effort to get our preschool accredited. We thank you for the exemplary status granted to our school. Grant that the accreditation process will serve as a continuing, ongoing blessing for our preschool, and also something that attracts people in the community to our program. Lord God, Lord of life and death, we thank you for all the mercies with which you blessed our fellow believer, Dorothy Hart, the mother of Donna Lane, now fallen asleep. We thank you for having brought her to the knowledge of your dear son, Jesus Christ. We pray that you would comfort Donna and her family with your precious promises and cheer them with the sure hope of a blessed reunion in heaven. Grant the lifeless body rest, and at last, together with us all, a joyful resurrection to life everlasting. Teach us all to number our days aright, that we may gain hearts of wisdom and finally be saved. Father, watch over our brother Andy Petrie, who is currently hospitalized in Florida and will soon begin several weeks of rehab to recover from a fractured hip. Care for and watch over Andy and Carol. Speed the healing process and grant to Andy a full recovery. And we thank you, Heavenly Father, for getting Sheila McBean through the first of her cataract surgeries. Hold your hand of blessing over her and the surgeon as she undergoes a second surgery, and allow these surgeries to be for Sheila a restoration of sight. We know, Father, that your love is unfailing. In your Son's Supper, he gives to us his blood, which is the blood of the new covenant, a contract and a commitment of love and forgiveness for your people. We ask that in your mercy we might receive this gift in a worthy manner, not doubting, but firmly believing that we are your people, redeemed by the blood of your Son. We ask all of this in Jesus' name. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts. We lift them up to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is good and right so to do.
It is our duty and delight at all times and in all places to give thanks to you, O Lord, Holy Father, Almighty, Everlasting God. And now we bless you that through Jesus Christ our Lord, we are shown limitless mercy and abiding love through his grace and forgiveness. Therefore, with all the company of heaven, we join in the ceaseless hymn and praise your glorious name, singing.
Oh,
In your righteous judgments, you condemned the sin of Adam and Eve, who ate the forbidden fruit, and you justly barred them and all their children from the tree of life. Yet in your great mercy, you promised salvation by a second Adam, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, and made his cross a life-giving tree for all who trust in him. We give you thanks for the redemption you have prepared for us through Jesus Christ. Grant us your Holy Spirit that we may faithfully eat and drink of the fruit of his cross and receive the blessings of forgiveness, life, and salvation that come to us in his body and blood. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, in whose name we join in praying, our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Then he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always. Amen. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of seated. During the distribution, we'll sing hymn 147. All things are now ready, let us come. Savior, Jesus Christ, given into death for all of your sins. Take and drink. This is the true blood of your Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, shed for you for the forgiveness of all of your sins. May this same body and blood strengthen you and preserve you in the true faith unto life everlasting. Depart in peace. Amen. This is the true body of your Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, given into death for all of your sins. Take and drink. This is the true blood of your Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, shed for you for the forgiveness of all of your sins. May this same body and blood strengthen you and preserve you in the true faith unto life everlasting. Depart in peace. Amen. Amen. Take and eat. This is the true body of your Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, given into death for all of your sins. Take and drink. This is the true blood of your Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, shed for you for the forgiveness of all of your sins. May this same body and blood strengthen you and preserve you in the true faith unto life everlasting. Depart in peace. Amen. Christ shed for you for the forgiveness of all of your sins. May this same body and blood strengthen you and preserve you in the true faith unto life everlasting. Depart in peace. Amen.
through Jesus Christ, given into death for all of your sins. Take and drink. This is the true blood of your Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, shed for you for the forgiveness of all your sins. May this same body and blood serve to strengthen and preserve you in the true faith unto life everlasting. Depart in peace.
Rise. Blessed are you, Almighty God, for you have shown your faithfulness to us and granted us places at your table once again, where we have been fed and nourished by the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. Send your Holy Spirit, that having now received this holy sacrament, we may by faith obtain the blessings of forgiveness of sins, life and salvation that come to us through this holy meal. We ask this through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace.
Amen. Amen.
Our closing hymn is hymn 496. love him, serving him to know his freedom. Come along with us to join the praise of Jesus. Come to Jesus now. Go to live his word rejoicing. Victory won for us. From the dead, living with the Father now, yet he is among us. We are the body, the head. Living is to love him, serving him to know his freedom. Come along with us to join the praise of Jesus. Come to Jesus now. Go to live his word rejoicing. One in love as family, living with each other. Gladly we share each other's pain. Yet he will not leave us, so soon he is returning, taking us back with him to reign. Living is to love him, serving him to know his freedom. Come along with us to join the praise of Jesus. Come to Jesus now. Go to live his word rejoicing.
Good morning.
Good morning.
There are a few announcements. In about 15 minutes, we'll begin with our education program of Sunday school and adult Bible class tonight. Confirmation class begins at the usual time at 5:30. This week, Monday through Thursday, rummage sale work is going to be going on here at church from 6 to 8, and then this Saturday and Friday, a rummage sale at the times that are announced in the bulletin. Tuesday, the choir will rehearse also at 7 p.m. And on Thursday, we'll have Green Team. We kind of had hoped to do the pine car races, but we're going to do something else and save the pine car races for another day. Because if we put the pine car track out, it just might be sold at the rummage sale. And we don't want that. As far as other things, we did have the accreditation visit this past Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday, and we are thankful to God for getting through that and passed that with exemplary status. So some work still needs to be done, but that was a big, momentous thing for our preschool. The enrollment for preschool right now, I believe, stands at 18, and we'll have a visit from another mother this coming week for the four-year-old class, which would get us to 19, so that would be a great thing. There is something to eat and drink after the service today. You're all invited to stay for that before we get going with the education program. And then also today is Autumn and John O'Mara's anniversary, so happy anniversary to you as well. I believe that those are all of the announcements.